they had a deal where the bride and groom would not kiss unless you went up and sang part of a lyric to them. So Jen and I went up and sang, "If you want my love, you got it. If you need
my love, you got it. I won't hide it. I won't throw your love away."
Woo! You hit one note correct, I guess.
Hey there, Ray.
That was a big wow. Hello and welcome to another episode of When Records Ruled, the podcast where we share a love of rock music and pop culture from the 70s and 80s and take a few B-side tracks down memory lane along the way. So get out those liner notes, dig into that fresh box of Twinkies, because it's time to hit the play button. I'm your host, David Norris, and joining me on this flashback musical road trip are my good friends Brian Strom and Lance Schwartz. Who needs another hostess snack?
Wasn't a big Twinkie guy.
No?
No.
Ding Dong?
Ding Dong? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Ho-Ho? Oh, yeah. Same thing. Susie
different shape.
Yeah, exactly.
Ho-Ho's have the chocolate
swirl
on the outside.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, those are good.
Yeah. Chocolate coating and Ding Dongs, too. It was basically the same thing.
And they originally came in foil. Remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, they did. Yep.
Yep.
And then at lunch, you open them up, you flatten them out, and then you push them on your face, and you make a print of your nose and all that kind of stuff.
I never did the imprint on my face. Yeah. We would just make them into like either a cube and like, you know, really flatten them and like rub it on the table.
Yeah.
Or the perfect ball.
Perfect ball. And then you throw it at somebody.
Exactly.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then we think we took a few Twinkies and popped them like zits too. Oh,
yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I tried one like, you know, in my late teens or early 20s one time. Not a good taste.
Mm.
No, did not remember
that.
Oh, all right, let's move on here. For today's episode, we will be discussing the album Moving Pictures by the Canadian prog rock group Rush.
Eh?
That's right, eh? We'll hear what was happening around the time of the album's release, wrap it up with our personal rating of the album, and then we'll end the show with our Remember When segment. So, to get us going, Lance has some details to share about the album.
Yes, indeed. Moving Pictures is the eighth studio album by Canadian, as you mentioned.
That's right, eh?
Rock band Rush. It was released on February 12th, 1981 in the U.S. on Mercury Records, but I guess it might have been Anthem Records in Canada. Nope. I did not have an Anthem copy. Mine was a Mercury copy.
Same.
So Moving Pictures was recorded after the band concluded their tour for their previous album, Permanent Waves. They started writing and recording the new material in August 1980. So, yeah, they turned that around, what?
6 months.
Pretty quick, really, considering. They worked with a producer named Terry Brown, who actually had been involved with all of their previous albums as well, and they stuck with him, I think, through, what was the album after this?
Signals.
Fire Hydrant.
Fire Hydrant.
Yep. Through that album, anyway. Some would say that this was maybe their most radio-friendly album up to this point. And considering the length of some of the songs, you know, they were much shorter. And I'll maybe get into a little bit about Geddy Lee's vocal delivery, too, that I think made it a little more radio friendly. The album had three singles that were released: Limelight, Tom Sawyer, and Vital Signs. I didn't know Vital Signs was released as a single.
I did not either.
But
never heard that on the radio.
Yeah, me neither. Must have not charted very high.
No.
According to this research I did, the album has sold 5 million copies, but that's got to be old. I'm guessing it's a little more than that. Did you guys find...
They don't update that stuff anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, probably the 90s were the last time.
And then the band supported the album on tour from February to July, 81. Fairly short tour, too, really.
Yeah, really. It is.
But, you know, that was back in the day, I think, when you were expected to crank out an album a year and... tour to support, and it just kept you know, the cycle kept going. Nowadays, it seems like you wait 3-4 years, or if it's Boston, a dozen.
Eight.
Anyway, a little more about Terry Brown. Besides working with Rush, he worked with the band Cutting Crew.
Heard of them.
Another prog rock band from Canada called Klaatu. I've never heard of them.
Nope.
Or Klaatu, K-L-A-A-T-U.
You guys have never heard of them.
Maybe. You heard of them?
I like both of their... No, I'm kidding. I have no idea
who they are. Chilliwack. I mean, if you throw that at me, yeah.
Did he work with Chilliwack too?
No. Oh. But they were Canadian, weren't they?
What you gonna do?
Yeah.
They might have been.
Okay.
I don't know. Well, one other Canadian band he worked with is a band that I personally like called Blue Rodeo.
Never heard of Blue Rodeo?
No.
Look them up. Pretty good. I would say they're more alt country, sort of.
Oh, okay. Mm.
List of credits. Whoa. Brian's a little excited about Blue Rodeo.
Sorry. Why don't you back that up? You're trying to silence your phone and you're like...
I was going to look something up and it just was on.
All right. Sorry, Lance.
That's all right.
I'm here to confirm that Chilliwack is Canadian.
Okay.
Thank you, Brian.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Google.
Okay, I think that's enough. I don't have an awful lot on this. There was not much interesting anyway on my reliable Wikipedia source. Is that enough for...
You tell me, big guy.
I just think so.
Make something up.
There's one more fact. One more fact. It doesn't matter if it's true or not.
This album, believe it or not, they recorded completely in the nude. It was this...
Wow.
What, really?
I didn't know that.
Nope.
I don't want to know how you found that on the internet.
No, you don't want to know.
That's right.
But you don't want to see the video.
Oh, man. Okay.
That makes for a slippery drum seat.
Okay. Let's move on. To give us an even better frame of reference, Brian is here with some information and fun facts on what was happening around the time the album was released.
February 12th, 1981. Some of the top bands of the time were Blondie, Steely Dan, one of Lance's favorites here, AC/DC.
Sweet. Yeah.
Bruce Springsteen and Pat Benatar.
All good stuff.
That was kind of like peak Back in Black, maybe just before for those about to rock. They were huge.
Yep.
Yeah. I saw them twice in the 2-year span on the Back in Black tour. And then I'm trying to remember if they opened there for those about to rock. And it was early in that For Those About to Rock tour when I saw them. We were in the fifth row. Oh, wow. My goodness. That was a lot of fun.
Did you hear anything after that?
Not for about 3 weeks, maybe. So
I think we talked about that in our concerts episode.
Yeah.
I'm going to go back and hear more about that.
Yes. Good. Hey.
The callback. I'm all about the callback.
All right. The top three songs on the Billboard charts. Number 3, I Love a Rainy Night.
Eddie Rabbit.
Oh, correct.
Yeah. I know that song.
9 to 5, number 2.
Dolly Parton.
Correct. And
it's a race now.
Celebration.
Cool the Gang.
Yes.
You know, I was hoping for another country tune there.
I know. I was thinking the same thing.
Who would it have been?
They're like treating it Ronnie Millsap or something, maybe.
Yeah, Smoky Mountain Rain, baby.
There you go. All right. Top TV shows around that time. One Day at a Time. Alice.
Oh, yeah.
Different Strokes, Trapper John MD, and then Chips.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Ponch and John.
Ponch and John. And Sergeant Gatrere.
Yep.
And Grossman.
Grossman. That's the guy I was trying to think of. That was getting they made fun of all the time.
That's right.
Oh, man.
Alice was pretty good, too. Remember Flo?
Yes.
Yep.
Kiss my grits.
Yes. Right.
Movies. Go ahead, Dave. Dave's got something there.
No, okay. I don't. Yeah.
Movies at the time. Raiders of the Lost Ark, On Golden Pond, and Cannonball Run.
That was a great movie.
Yeah, it was a great movie in the day. I just watched it like 6 months ago. It's terrible.
Yeah, you didn't like Smokey and the Bandit either. Come on.
That's true.
Cannonball Run was awesome. It was just an excuse to get the all-star cast together.
Yeah, it was a big all-star cast.
I love that movie.
Kind of like... episode of Love Boat, right?
Right, yeah.
Bunch of B-listers and...
Yeah.
No, but let's see. Burt Reynolds was in Cannonball Run, right?
Yep.
And Dom DeLuise.
Yeah.
And the elephant.
That was the can. That was no. That oh, that was Smoking the Bandit 2. You're talking about, right?
Oh,
the elephant. Oh, yeah.
All right. We're moving on here. Toys around this time period. Try Ominos.
I remember.
Anybody?
I didn't play it, but I remember seeing it.
We had it.
We had that too.
It looked like fun.
Yep.
Was it fun?
It was fun. So. Yeah. It was like three times the fun.
Oh, man.
Smurf figures.
Yeah.
How about the game Mastermind?
That was an awesome game.
That was fun.
We played that all the time camping because it was a good like travel game.
Yep, exactly.
It was so small.
Exactly.
I love that game.
I don't remember it.
Sitting in the camper.
Yep.
Doing that one. Yeah. Nope.
Doesn't ring a bell.
And then also at this time, Garfield figures and stuffed animals were getting
the ones
big,
that were stuck to the windows.
Stuck in the windows and all that.
Yep. I had a Garfield. I was into Garfield in grade school.
Oh, yeah.
And I think I might have had like little one stuffed animal, but I had like all 12 books at the time. It was like a kind of a collection. But then it just got...
I liked Garfield at the time because I could understand it. I could get the jokes.
Yep.
The Marmaduke cartoons
were hilarious.
Yeah. But then it got to be very, very, very repetitive.
Yes.
No, not political. No. Everything. I don't think he's ever been political. Just repetitive. He loves lasagna. He hates
Odie.
Hates his owner. Disrespects his owner. I mean, repeat.
No.
Anyway.
All right. That's all I got.
All right. Gents, let's say we break for a road trip to the great white north so we can get in the right frame of mind to talk about the Rush album, Moving Pictures. Buckle up.
Oh, look. Snow.
It's such a great opener.
Has there ever been a band that you wanted to air drum more to than Rush?
No, that's a good point.
And I said opener. It's a great opening to that song. I mean, if you didn't get my Great White North reference, it's a nickname for Canada, by the way, for all those who don't know what that is, where the band's from. I think we mentioned it at the top of the episode here.
Yep.
It's also an album by Bob and Doug McKenzie.
Yes.
If you haven't heard of them, Google them, eh?
Take off.
That's right.
Hey. I have a story about Limelight.
I have a story about Take Off.
Well, let's get to yours, Brian. So, we'll hold yours till we talk about Limelight.
So Bob and Doug McKenzie, Rick Moranis, and Geddy Lee were schoolmates. So during grade school for like 6 years. So when they did their album, their
Bob and Doug McKenzie
comedy album, they had Geddy Lee in to sing Take Off.
Yeah, I remember that.
And they recorded it very quickly. I think he said maybe 15 minutes.
I believe he
did his part. And the highest chart that a Rush member has ever been on, the song, is Take Off by Bob and Doug McKenzie.
Wasn't even his own song.
Nope. And they were in the teens. They made it up into the teens.
Wow.
Not surprising, is it?
It's just pop culture.
Yes.
Flash. Yeah. Guys.
Yes.
Before we get going here, I'd like to start the discussion with a footnote. It's where we're discussing an album that I actually own.
What?
But I bought this album. I have the CD.
Nice. Whoa.
I bought it in the 80s. Yep. I don't really remember when I bought it, unfortunately. But I'm pretty familiar with this one. So I was pretty excited when I knew we were going to be reviewing this one.
Oh, it's going to be so easy for you, Dave.
I know, right?
That's good.
You guys have any... That's
good. We need you to contribute. You know what?
I don't have anything to say, Dave. What do you got?
I got nothing, man.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. You guys have any first impressions that you remember from listening to this album?
Yeah, actually. Because I was into Rush prior to this coming out.
Okay.
Quite a bit into Rush. I mean, had 2112 and Caress of Steel and Fly By Night and Farewell to Kings. I had them all.
Wow.
And I really liked 2112. Did I mention that?
No. You did.
I did.
I missed that one.
Yeah.
That was, I think, the first Rush album I ever bought.
Wow.
So when this came out, I guess I was in high school, and this was markedly different than some of those previous albums. Mainly because the songs were shorter, some of them, most of them. And they were a little less complex.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it, well, 21 yeah,
for 12, Rush.
For Rush, for sure. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, good point. I mean, they're all terrific musicians. So, yeah, it struck me as really, wow, this is different, but this is really good. I liked it a lot. It might be, in my opinion, the pinnacle for Rush.
Mm-hmm.
Because things changed considerably after this album. And you'd have to ask the guys, the two remaining guys, why that is. But it seemed like they decided to go a little more. I mean, they're always maybe kind of experimental in what they did. But they became even more experimental.
Mm-hmm. After this album?
After this album, yeah. Yeah. But when it came out, it was huge. It was big. And I must have bought it right away. Can't remember for sure though.
Yeah, I think pretty sure I did. My brother bought this cassette right away, and so I remember hearing it them. First time hearing Tom Sawyer, I was familiar with, you know, some of their radio hits prior to that. Didn't own anything.
Hits, quote unquote.
Right. Yeah. They probably were bigger hits after this came out, and then, you know what I mean? Like going back into their catalogs, and then you start hearing more Rush after they started to get more popular. But I do remember hearing Tom Sawyer for the first time. I mean, not really specifically, but just what a completely different sound. Just like, wow, what is this? And that kind of blew me away. I was still I was 10 or 11, so I wasn't listening to rock radio or anything. I was just listening to the top 40 stuff.
Yeah.
So this came up. And then I do remember a few years later, I bought one of those KTEL records.
That compilation?
Was, yeah. And it was called Masters of Metal.
Oh, I think I had that one.
And they have Rush on there.
Yeah.
And I saw that. I was like, yes, Tom Sawyer. I was like so excited. It was a live version.
Oh, no.
So disappointed. I'm like, oh, no.
I don't remember that. Good, it was probably from like Exit Stage Left,
I'm sure.
But wasn't like Y&T and Black Sabbath?
Yes. And, yeah. Yep.
That was a pretty Iron good Maiden. KTEL.
It was a really and crocus.
The cover, yeah. Yeah. The cover was really cool.
Great cover.
It wasn't your typical KTEL cover.
Yeah.
If you can picture a typical KTEL cover.
I can.
Yeah.
Because we had a few of those compilations. Yeah. Nothing rock or metal related.
Yeah.
A lot of silly songs and maybe a country compilation or something like that. But
yeah. So that was my really first experience with them.
I do remember kind of, you know, I think the main reason I bought this album was Tom Sawyer, because I'd hear that and go, wow, this is such an awesome song. I need to buy the album. That's the way you got it.
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, I really liked a lot of the other songs and grew to like them and would listen to the entire album.
I think maybe the reason that people say it's like more commercial is just because they had more shorter songs on it.
Mm-hmm.
Although they still had a lot of, I mean, they got a 10, 11 minute song on this one.
Mm-hmm.
They always had some shorter, catchy, radio friendly songs prior to this. So,
yeah, I mean,
I don't know that was a real big departure, but,
I think when we get into the songs, I'll talk a little bit about Getty's vocal delivery on a couple of these that makes me think it was maybe crafted a little more to get some radio airplay, but we'll talk about that.
Just toning it down a little bit, maybe?
Yeah, I think you're on something there.
Yeah,
I read something similar. We'll get into that.
You read that?
A little bit.
Really?
Yeah, that he was trying to like say he can only scream for so long.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And I did not read that. This is something I actually came up with on my own.
Oh, well. I just came up with my thing on my own.
Well, I'll back you both up.
We kind of know a little bit about music.
Hey, it's crazy.
Wow.
You have to change the little saying at the end. We actually do know something.
That's right. No.
Not going to go there. Let's talk about the cover just a little bit here, because I thought it was a really interesting cover and I was doing some research on it. It's a triple entendre. And so what that means...
Like triominos.
Exactly. So there's just a lot going on here with the name Moving Pictures. So that is implying a lot of different things. There's literally people moving pictures on the cover.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
There are people being moved, like to tears or emotionally moved by that. by the moving pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And on the back of the album, there's like a live video crew filming them moving pictures.
Yes.
Another moving picture.
And I know I was telling Brian this earlier on the CD I have, the liner notes contain the pictures that are on the back of the LP, the action pictures, which are taken with like a strobe light of Geddy Lee, Neil Peart, and Alex Lifeson. But my copy does not contain Neil. And I was always wondering, like, why wouldn't you include a photo of the drummer in your liner notes? So there must have been mm-hmm. some kind of cost-saving measure.
Well, it was when CDs came out, and there was a lot of inner fighting with the band, and they're like, we're just going to leave him out and
stuff up.
I thought it was foreshadowing that That's Neil right. would yeah. be the first one to pass yeah. away.
So a few more details about the cover too. It's a photo and taken in front of the Ontario Legislative Building in downtown. That's Rush's hometown, Toronto, downtown Toronto. There's a painting of dogs playing poker, which was Neil Peart's idea.
That's an iconic.
Yeah, it is. It was on loan from Minnesota, by the way.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I read that too.
Is that at the Institute of Arts?
No.
Seriously.
No, there's some collection that they have of these, I think, or some.
But the original is in Minnesota.
That's what I read anyway.
Yeah. Well, we need to go see it because yeah. that's awesome.
You can order your own copy, actually.
No, I want to see the original.
Oh, okay.
I want to carry the original.
Yeah.
Yeah. You do. In a red jumpsuit.
They're also carrying the Starman character from 2112.
Yep.
And a burning Joan of Arc figure, which is actually a photograph of the photographer. What's her name here?
Is it a selfie?
I lost it. I don't know that it's called a selfie. So does it
not find her name? Yet.
Deborah Samuels, a photographer. So this whole thing orchestrated and directed by Hugh Simey, who also plays synth on one of the songs we'll talk about later here too. But his whole, and he's designed and directed like multiple Rush covers.
Hmm.
Like I didn't count up how many, but it's at least a half a dozen
really?
Or more. Yeah. I think that
this one had a lot of moving
did
parts.
Did I read?
Oh, one more thing.
Good one.
The painting or the photo, Joan of Arc character, kind of a reference to Witch Hunt as well. Mm. So they're kind of referencing that in there.
Did I read somewhere that the cost of producing the cover
$6,000. Yeah.
I read that it was maybe a little more than that. Either way, whatever it is, the record company didn't want to pay for it. So the band had to pay some.
Not all of it. They didn't want to pay for all of it. Yeah. So the band had to
chip in.
Pay out of their pocket. Yeah.
And you think about $6,000.
That's nothing.
Today.
Well, even today, what is that? Maybe, I don't know.
I don't know what the equation is. $25,000. Yeah.
Something like that.
So they must have been like, oh, no, we're not doing that. Anyway.
Well, they saved money by using all their buddies and friends
they did.
And family members. And
yep. There's also one of the guys who's filmed holding one of the pictures is shown in there twice.
Mm.
So I'm not sure how they photographed that or superimposed him or whatever. But the guy on the far left is also the guy holding a picture on the steps where you can only see like the back of his head.
It looks, I'm looking at it right now. Concur.
Yeah.
It looks very much like
you've confirmed that. All right. Good.
Yeah. All right. One more note. Rolling Stone has listed this album at number 3 on the 2015 list of 50 greatest prog rock albums of all time.
Really?
Mm. Any guesses to number 1?
Yes. Man. Fragile.
No. Mm. It's a Pink Floyd album.
Oh. Dark Side of the Moon.
Dark Side of the Moon. Yep.
Okay. And what's number 2?
I didn't make a note of that one. I knew somebody was going to probably like ask that. And I'm like, I'll remember that. I don't need to make a note.
Stump the Dave.
No.
Yes, Fragile.
No.
The Yes album?
Yes.
No. All right. You guys ready to talk some tracks?
Let's talk tracks.
Let's do it. Okay. Like usual, I'm going to go through and name off the tracks. We'll circle around and start talking about track number 1 on side number 1. Side 1, Tom Sawyer, Red Barchetta. YYZ, or as Rush calls it, YYZ.
Zed.
Limelight. And then we flip over to side 2, The Camera Eye, Witch Hunt, and Vital Signs. Not a lot of songs in this album, but they're mediocre in length.
But 40 minutes total.
But 40 minutes, yeah. I mean, it's a decent long album. We're going to start off with a bang here, guys. Tom Sawyer.
Kind of a tale of two sides on this album, too, by the way. Tom Sawyer. Isn't that synth cool?
Yeah.
I mean, that kind of makes this song unique among rock songs.
That's what I was saying when I first heard that. I was just like, whoa.
Yeah.
I mean, because I can't think of any other song that would sound anything like that.
You immediately know it's this song.
Yeah, right.
That wave of synth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the, you know, the kind of downward note it takes or something, whatever it does. Man, it's just awesome.
And there's a synth solo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That leads right into a guitar solo.
It's as, like, as they're building it up.
Seamless. Yep. Yeah. Yep. It's really cool. So that, I mean, the song itself is great. I mean, it's fun to sing along to, and it's a rocker, but that synth is what really grabs me as something unique. And they've used synths before, but I think just the way they used it in this particular track, it was very cool.
Fair to say this is the most famous Rush song?
I think so. And I call it Rush in a nutshell. I mean, if you were just,
yeah.
I mean, if you're going to introduce somebody to Rush, boom, this is what you give them. Yeah. This will kind of give you the best feel of what Rush is.
Yeah. I mean, each musician is featured.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's
like
a lot of
songs. Yeah.
Yeah.
They all get a little piece of the pie.
Yeah. Yeah. Some more than others or longer, I guess. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, you're right.
I think what's unique, and this is kind of what I was referring to earlier, the vocal delivery is really a different take for Geddy Lee from what I heard on previous albums, where he's just reaching way up there. I mean, he tried to keep this in a normal range.
Yeah.
And it must have been intentional because he still could hit those notes.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very different, and I wonder if it was to make this a little more approachable and radio friendly. There was an effort, I think, to have that happen with the band with this album. So,
and his delivery too is very distinct. I mean, he's emphasizes every word.
Articulates every word.
Articulates, yes, that's the word.
Did he not do that with some previous songs? Because I didn't, I mean, like Spirit of Radio, and I'm familiar with that one.
Oh, and that one's, I mean, he gets way up there in that.
But isn't it as articulate or not?
I don't know.
It's just different. I agree, Brian. There's a
little different
bit
different
feel,
delivery.
Yep, feel to it.
I also heard a bit of a demo of the song before that, and it was faster.
Wow.
And the drums in the beginning just, I mean, they're kind of driving pretty quick. And they decided we got to slow this down so we can understand the lyrics better, so you can hear it and know what's going on.
They wanted to play it faster originally.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
That's kind of cool.
That's not surprising either, considering, you know, their back catalog and this stuff really, a lot of it flew.
Right. Right.
Trying to think of it just was completely different than anything I'd heard from them before. And then of course you can't mention any Rush album without the brilliant drumming of Neil Peart.
And, right.
You know, we were just saying before, you just want to air drum along.
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because the parts are, what's the best way of saying this? The drums are not just keeping beat. They're really part of the music.
Right.
In Rush.
Well, he felt that he couldn't repeat himself. He always wanted to have something different and new.
Oh boy. So like, he did a good job at that.
You know, they would tell him like, yeah, just do this groove. And he's like, no, I've done that before. Like, you know, you can repeat a groove. You know,
he said,
if a groove is good, you can still use that groove. But he didn't want to do that. So that's why all these are so different, and these time changes and everything. It's just, wow.
Yeah.
It's just crazy.
Some of these are, I can't imagine trying to drum this myself, you know, like going into YYZ and stuff, and there's so many changes going on.
Yeah.
And even just the beginning of it, just knowing the timing of what's going on.
Right.
I didn't know you were a drummer, Dave.
No, I mean, I'm just trying to think, if I had to do this, I can't even keep it straight of what's coming up.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you're like, oh man, not good. Wouldn't be good for me.
Yeah, and you know, not only is that the drums in not just this song, but all Rush songs, there's, like Brian was saying, there's so many changes that I can't remember what tune it was they said was so difficult they didn't even try to replicate it. Was it something from Hemispheres, maybe? Like,
they were trying to replicate it on this album?
No, no. I'm saying is there was a particular track on Hemispheres, and I can't remember the name of it right now, but they said, we made it so complex that it was difficult to even recreate in concert.
Sure. Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I'll have to look back and see if I can remember what that is.
You were talking about Geddy Lee, actually. I read some stuff on each of these songs, but one of these quotes I got from Geddy Lee was, he talked about the one song that we have to play for the rest of our lives.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When we wrote it, we had no idea that it would touch such a nerve with people. In many ways, it's the quintessential Rush song. So kind of like what you were saying, Brian, if you're handing someone Rush for the first time, this is the song you start them with.
Yep. And you will be hooked.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, they owned it. I saw them, I think only twice. First time was in the early 21st century. I'd say like maybe 06 or 08, something like that. I wish I had seen them earlier, but I hadn't. And what was the first song? Tom Sawyer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't be late to the show.
Yeah, right. What? I missed. Yeah. Can you imagine that? Yeah. You're waiting to get to the end. It's like, wait a minute, they didn't play Tom Sawyer.
No. Yeah.
Right. First song.
5 minutes late. Well, 6 minutes late. Boom. Done.
I do remember the live video for this song playing on MTV a lot. And so that was, I remember that connection.
Yeah, I don't remember the video, but
I remember black and red. I mean, just those colors, dark stage, black.
So it was a concert video.
It was a concert video. Yeah, it was live.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
The director for the album cover mentioned that too. When I was reading about whether album covers he's done, black, red, and something else are kind of themes he goes. So if you look at a lot of the album covers or the artwork, he uses those three colors a lot. Mm. Black, red, white, I can't remember now.
I can tell you what the song was I was referring to.
Oh, yeah?
From Hemispheres. La Via Strangiato.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
No, no. What? Not familiar with it, sorry.
Aren't you?
Sounds cool. No, I'm not. Maybe I've heard it. I don't know.
No, it's a good album. Hemispheres is a very good album.
A little fun fact for you guys. I don't know if you knew this or not. Probably not. The song was used as the opening music to the Brazilian dub of the spy TV show MacGyver.
No, I did not know that.
I was like, Brian, there was a cover band that played at college that we saw. They were called Wayne's World.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what song they opened with?
Tom Sawyer?
Good guess. Yeah. I was super excited when I heard that.
Oh, yeah.
That
was
fun. And it sounded like the synth programming they did.
Yeah.
Sounded pretty close.
Yep.
So it was pretty exciting.
So my classmate from Bethany was Wayne Cropa. Rest in peace.
Wayne. Yep.
Yep.
Who else was
Mike
in
Dale?
Mike
Dale, yeah. Scott.
So was it Scott Killian?
Scott Killian, me? I don't know.
I can't remember. I think he was playing guitar too. Yeah.
I can picture the drummer.
Gilbertson?
I don't know.
I can't remember his name now, anyway.
I have conversations with Mike occasionally, so I'll have to ask him if there's any recordings.
Yeah, there you go.
There is a video. They videotaped that.
Cool. Nice.
Yep. So I know that exists. All right. Let's move on to Red Barchetta. Really cool story about a dystopian future. I love this song.
Yeah.
It's a really cool song.
That's pretty heavy. Dystopian future.
Yeah. Have you not read up on that at all?
Nope. I thought it was about a guy driving fast.
It is.
But it's based off of a story.
Why is he doing that?
That Neil Peart read. And I can't remember the name of it. I actually have it like open in a tab and I didn't read the story. It was like in Road and Driver magazine or something like that, like years and years ago. And so he read that and kind of wanted to use that as a basis for a song and try to get in contact with the guy. Wasn't able to until after I think they wrote it and recorded it. But it's kind of based on this story.
Well, you know, when the song opens up with his uncle having a place out in the country that nobody knows about, you know something's going down.
Yeah, I was like, what's going on here?
Yeah, but it's Canada. There's a lot of wide open space.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, you know what got me on that was when they talk about it used to be a farm before the motor law. And I'm like, what? Do they have some kind of weird motor law in Canada? And that's what got me on the rabbit hole of like, no, there's no motor law. It's like a dystopian future. They talk about where cars are outlawed.
Yep.
Except for the flying. They talk about some flying alloy cars. Like that are some kind of authority.
Well, that's really interesting. I learned something tonight. Thank you, Dave.
It is. Oh, there's so many cool lyrics in this song. If you listen to it with kind of that in mind, you hear really cool stuff. Like one of the lyrics is, well-weathered leather, hot metal and oil, the scented country air, sunlight on chrome, the blur of the landscape, every nerve aware. And just, cool.
Can we talk about here we're talking about lyrics again. Yeah. Remember a few albums ago I was like, and trashy lyrics. Neil Peart was an incredible lyricist.
Yeah.
I think he must be a very well-read, or was a very well-read individual.
Yeah, him and Sting used to hang out a lot.
Well, why didn't they do an album together? Jeez.
I don't know. They had a book club.
They talk mythology a lot.
Yeah,
Methuselah.
I got to give it to Getty to be able to sing these lyrics.
Yeah,
and how he comes up with this stuff, because a lot of it is. I mean, there's rarely a chorus, really. I mean, there's kind of a chorus, but just the delivery of these songs and how are you going to sing these? And it's like, wow.
They're not all just like line, rhyme type of things. And so he just crafts these together somehow. Yeah, you're right. You're right. I was thinking about that too. Just, you know, you're not even the guy writing it, and yet you have to find a way to sing it. And I would imagine if something like, you know, if Sting's writing lyrics, he maybe kind of knows a way he wants to deliver it as he's writing it.
Yeah.
And maybe Neil talked with Getty about that. I don't know.
I don't know.
But it just seems like a tall order.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
And like, I mean, to be able to interpret, you know, what he's trying to say and how he's saying it is just, wow, that's impressive.
So here's another little tidbit towards the end, Lance. After the lyrics end, there's another minute three of music. Well, they kind of break this down. Well, first of all, let me back up here. So it talks about the lyrics talk about, you know, getting this car uncovered and then taking off. And the music just simulates that so well in my mind.
Oh, yeah.
With how it just talks, you can just hear and see visually in your mind's eye, the car just racing away and shifting and moving off and just
gravel flying.
Totally.
Yeah, blurred everything.
You know, as you say that, I'm looking at my notes. So the music kind of becomes the story of movement.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
This song marries those two so well in my mind, in my opinion. So after the lyrics end about 103, there's a music left. So here's what I imagine as they break down the rest of the song, because it starts to break down.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I'm trying to think of what's going on during that time in the story. And so I was thinking like, getting the car back to the farm building where the car is stored, and then revving it up, talking with his uncle about how, you know, he just escaped some authorities with these alloy air cars, pulling the car inside, packing things away,
covering it up,
getting ready for the evening fire time.
Yeah.
I can just totally picture that whole thing.
Gosh, I am never going to listen to this song in the same way again.
Oh,
and they
after understanding.
And they do this once a week.
It's
their weekend
every
thing.
Sunday.
Go out and take the car.
Hoping not to be caught.
Yeah. But I mean, it's just freeing, I think. It's a cool story.
Yep. Yeah. I would say too, Getty's vocals here are equally as subdued. Mm-hmm. He's not reaching.
Right.
It's just a really kind of straightforward, but still excellent delivery, as you're saying, you know, working with lyrics like this. But it's just way more approachable than some of the earlier albums. Just maybe that's what makes it, like I say, more approachable and maybe more radio friendly. Perhaps this is when women started listening to Rush a little more.
Did they? I don't know. You know?
Do they? There's got to be some.
Still about, well, the last concert I went to was probably still 3-1, maybe 4-1 men. But
They're no 80s hair band. Huh?
I like the end of this song where he's just kind of noodling around on the bass, and he's got a lot of cool just little stuff in the
I can kind of picture just like packing things up and just kind of everything just calming down for fire time where they're just going to just sit and chill.
Mm-hmm.
All right, you ready to move on here?
Yes.
YYZ or YYZ.
YYZ.
Yes.
You know what YYZ stands for, right?
I do now.
Yep.
You go ahead, tell us.
What's the call?
It's the airport.
Yeah, the call.
International Air Transport Association, the IATA.
Yeah, airport I didn't know code. What the right what airport code. Yeah.
I didn't just pick that off the top of my head. I had that written down.
Yeah. I got that from looking at my FlightAware app.
Yeah. So airport code for?
Toronto.
Toronto Pearson International Airport. Yep.
I don't know what Pearson is, but I know it's Toronto.
Toronto.
Yeah.
You know what it's also
designated
as? Brian, you tell us that one.
Well, this is the Morse code, right?
Yeah.
For the letters. And they heard that while they were flying. And am I right that Neil is a pilot?
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that either.
Maybe, maybe not. I thought I kind of read that. But anyway.
I didn't read that.
They heard that single and they made a note of that and said, that's a cool thing. So
it's the tempo of the song.
It's the thing that starts off.
Yeah.
You hear
so it's dashes and dots. So I'll give you them and you can write them down, because then if you listen back to the beginning of this, you get it right away. And it may take you a few times, but so it's YYZ in Morse code or dashes and dots. So it's dash dot dash 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 dot dash 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 dot dot.
You said absolutely nothing there, Dave.
I did, but if somebody write it down and then listen to YYZ, and that is the rhythm of this intro and in the song.
Mm-hmm.
It's really cool.
It is cool. And this is an instrumental.
Yes. There's a lot of stuff going on here.
And they loved when they were going back home and they would see that YYZ tag on their luggage, and they're like, we're finally going home.
Oh, is that why? Another reason they're like, this is a nice.
And if you listen to the solo, you kind of get that kind of happy kind of feeling when you're doing that. Coming home.
Yeah. I can hear it. It really shows off each of these musicians' proficiency.
I was just going to say that
throughout.
It was like at a jazz concert. Everybody got a little piece you can do. Hey, here's a little drum part. Here's the bass part. And
it's so captivating through the whole thing. There's enough changes. And I think you talked about, maybe Neil not repeating himself, but I mean, there's just so many changes in here.
Yeah.
Yep. And it's kind of funky in parts too.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It changes a lot, but.
Because I think of the bass. It's just good stuff. It's good.
It's awesome. Each one of them gets their turn to show off.
That's right.
In this song, for sure.
Geddy Lee is a pretty awesome bass player. One of the best.
I got a question.
Yeah.
Do you guys like the whip sound?
I actually do. I listened to that I actually listened to the song on the way over here to record.
Okay.
Does that bother you? I would like it less.
Three times bothers me. One time would I like. Cool. Yes. Yeah. And the second time, a little bit. The third time is like, I think you overdid it.
I was actually thinking what I remembered was there was only one of them, but then I heard it again. I'm like, that's cool.
But there's
another time.
But I will say they are all different. I mean, they're all a whip sound, but they're all a little bit different. So it's not like they had one sound and they repeated that sound three times.
There's something layered in there besides the whip, though. It sounds like a chain or something.
Yeah, like a ksh, yeah. Yeah.
Maybe a crash cymbal or splash cymbal or something like that.
I was not listening close enough. To have it, bother me, I guess, or make an impression on me.
Yeah. I mean, it's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Brian's being nitpicky. He's just being picky on something.
I know. Come on.
Geddy Lee, you know where he ranks on the rock bass player list at all?
Well, whose list was it?
Rolling Stone.
Probably top 10.
50 greatest bassists of all time. He is 24.
24.
Do you know who he points to for the greatest bass player that he will name?
John Entwistle.
Bingo.
Wow.
From The Who.
Yeah.
Nailed it. You must have read that.
I did not.
You did not. Well, no. That's a great guess.
No.
Boris the Spider.
Yeah, he just talks about how so effortlessly John just slides up and down.
Which is true.
Yeah. Yeah. When you watch, he's just stoic up there.
He doesn't look like he's doing anything, and his hands just and it's clean.
And the bass is really high.
Yeah,
it's just
super clean.
He could not jump as high as Pete Townsend could. No, so he's just true. I'm going to hang back here.
Well, between the other three members of the Who, he's like, I can't compete with that probably. And like, why? Why exactly. would you want to, right?
Exactly.
Those are all egomaniacs. He's just going to, I'm going to play my bass.
I did make one other note on the song. The guitar solo, I thought, sounded very Eddie Van Halen-ish.
At a point in there, it did.
I heard that tonight on the way over, too. I'm like, you know what? There's a little influence there.
Yep.
And it wasn't like super overt, but it was just a little kind of some tapping things.
Then
he moved away.
Kind of a little.
I don't know if
I wasn't going to bring that up. But
I wouldn't call it an influence either. I wonder if it was just, you know what? I can do that too. I mean, Lifeson's an incredible guitar player.
Yeah. I was borrowing the style. I mean, it's a new technique. He's borrowing the technique.
Of course, it was what, 5 years after?
It was only like 3 years. Two or three years
after.
If they record this
in 80, come out
78. So this is actually only 2 years later when they were recording this.
Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, it was reminiscent of, I can't remember the Scorpion song where you're thinking, oh, it's got a little Eddie. And it was kind of that same, not even the tapping, but just the feel of it just had that.
Just a little section of it though.
Just a little section.
I had that same thought tonight.
Yep.
Yeah. All right, let's move on to the next song. The last one on the first side here, Limelight.
Love it.
Clearly the song that they said, we got to get this out to radio because radio is going to eat this up.
Like you said, Brian, in our last episode, lyrics you can understand make a difference, right? You can understand all the lyrics in this one. You can understand what's going on. It's not a complicated message by any means. Directly alluding to the next song on the album too. Talking about the camera.
Yeah. The thing is funny with this one that Neil wrote this because he hated the Limelight.
Yeah.
And then he writes this lyric and then they have one of their biggest songs and it only got worse for him after this. So if he hated it at this point, wow, you're really going to hate it for the next.
I can't tell really if it was about loathing, liking, it was just an opinion of being in the limelight.
He did not like the limelight.
No, I know that, but I couldn't gather from the lyrics that he hated it. I didn't feel that way in the song to me. It was just this is what the limelight is.
Yeah. Yeah, I would agree with you, Lance.
Thanks, Dave.
Yeah,
appreciate it.
That it's not like him just bemoaning the fact that they're famous and being in the limelight all the time.
Right.
And that's a well-established fact, too, that he did not like, you know, even interacting with fans on the meet and greets.
No.
He won't be there.
No, he was not part of that.
There's a quote from him says, I can't pretend a stranger is a long-awaited friend.
Yeah.
So, that just sums it up.
Quote.
Yeah. So.
He was very honest about what the limelight was and wasn't part of it.
So he didn't even show up for the photo shoot on the
CD.
That's why he wasn't in the CD.
On my version.
Yeah, that's why he wasn't in there. I don't want anyone to recognize me. I don't want people to know who I am.
Yeah. Well, and this kind of points out, this was the first single released.
Mm-hmm.
So this kind of points out what they thought would be a good radio song, not knowing how big Tom Sawyer would ever be.
Right.
Because it's so much bigger than Limelight.
Was Tom Sawyer the second one?
Tom Sawyer was the third single, actually.
Which is funny.
Yeah,
so,
I know.
So Vital Signs?
Vital Signs was number two.
Yeah. Which, I don't even remember ever hearing that on the radio.
No, I don't either.
What do we know? We're not record executives, right?
Maybe that was in Canada where Vital Signs was the more popular.
We're ready to flip it over?
Well, no, I said
you got more.
Before I had a story about Limelight.
Sorry.
When I was in high school, I can't remember, I must have been a senior. Like it or not, I was homecoming king.
Ah, congratulations.
Wow. Jeez, thank you.
And it's gotten you far in life.
Yeah, it sure has.
That's why you made the podcast.
I always wondered why you came in here wearing a crown every single time we do this show.
Can't let it go.
It's getting old.
Okay. Had nothing to do with that. But anyway, we had a homecoming roller skating event.
Oh, wow. Fun.
And I recall they had a DJ. Remember they had DJs in the booth at the roller skating rink?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So, you know, we were listening to the normal Michael Jackson, Cool in the Gang, Lionel Richie, blah, blah, blah. I went up and said, can you play Limelight by Rush? And they're like, yeah. But, well, there was a group of maybe a half a dozen of us guys that just... Rush, and we got out there. Nobody else could.
Everybody cleared the floor, right?
Yeah,
you got the whole floor to yourselves.
We loved it, and I'll never forget that I was roller skating to Limelight. So there you go. That's my story about Limelight.
Awesome.
It's been one of my favorites ever since.
That just reminded me of roller skating rinks at that time when the DJ's like right next to the thing, and every time you go by you yell a song at him that you want him to play. You're like, Limelight. Come by your Limelight. It's so funny.
And you tell your friends, hey, go tell him.
Go tell him this. Maybe he'll play it.
All right. You ready to flip it over?
Flipper.
Here's our cool flip sound. There we go.
Whoa.
All right. The camera eye. I saw on here that there's like two parts to this.
Yeah.
I'd never heard that before. One of them is AKA New York.
Yep.
And the second part is London. And from what I saw, that it was where Neil Peart had kind of wrote different sections of it when he was walking around these two different places. Is that right?
I don't know.
No, that's.
I do know there was two different parts. But,
okay.
Yeah.
Geddy Lee, by the way, said, for me, it didn't age very well.
Okay. Well, to me, it sounded more, well, this whole side sounded a little more similar to early Rush.
Yep.
There's a distinct difference between these
the radio
two sides.
Friendly side and the first side, and then the other stuff that we want to do for the diehard fans and for us.
And it feels, it's kind of a light tune to me. There's nothing real wild about it. It doesn't really take off and go anywhere.
It's too long.
Yeah.
I got a note about that at the end.
Yeah.
But you know, that's Rush too.
Right. I mean, typically, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, what 2112 was like 18 minutes or something like that.
Right. But I felt that, you know, you had the two different parts. Was it New York and London?
Yes.
It seemed like those two parts were the same, just with different lyrics.
Exactly. Yeah.
So it's like,
that's what I'm saying. Didn't
you know,
really go anywhere.
Just drop one of them and have a 7-minute song. And it would have been better.
The song is almost 11 minutes long.
Yeah.
So it's supposed to tell the story of life in the city kind of musically. Is that what I get out of it?
Yeah.
I didn't read that, but it seems logical.
I'll be honest. I mean, I love this album, but I didn't listen to this side that much. It was always the other side.
Yeah.
This is a very dated synth sound to start this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this actually pegs the decade and the time frame more so than even Tom Sawyer. Tom Sawyer, not as much as this one, I think.
Right.
But I still dig it, you know, especially when all the instruments kick in at the beginning. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately for me, it's like a super dated synth sound when this thing starts.
This was the last kind of long epic song that Rush did.
Ever?
For the most part, yeah.
Wow.
Yep. They kind of abandoned that.
Yeah.
So here's a very maybe unpopular idea of editing this song. I was thinking about this as I was listening to the different movements.
Mm-hmm. Be careful.
I know. And, you know.
The Rush fans are diehards.
Yeah, that's right. I'm sure it's a perfect song in most people's eyes. No, I just thought of this. Since it has these kind of different movements, what if you cut off the first 2:21 when you start getting into like the upbeat stuff? Where it goes into transition, actual time signature, the rest of the song. It's less dated. Mm-hmm. Same goes for taking that same transition midway through the song.
Yeah.
You're probably cutting off 4 minutes.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah. I totally agree. I thought the lead in was way too long. It's like, are there lyrics to this?
But then they transition into something else, which could have been just the start of the song, I think.
Yeah.
So if I'm going to critique something, that would be my suggestion for this one.
Anyway. Give me two or three songs instead of this one song.
Yeah. Which you could.
I mean, I like
doing 12 minutes.
I mean, it's not like. I do like long epic songs because some are really cool.
Yeah.
But if I really break it down, it's like, yeah, I might want to have, for that same space, give me two or three different songs.
Yeah. But, Anything else on Camera Eye?
Nope.
Let's go on a witch hunt then.
We're going on a witch hunt?
That's right.
Is this literally a witch hunt?
Well,
the song? No. It kind of sounds like the beginning. It's like the band and crew, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like outside on some cold day.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like a mob. It really does.
It does. They said they had 12 different layers of...
Oh, wow. That
on there. They said when they were listening back to it, they had a bottle of scotch out there having a good time. Yeah. They said they were just in hysterics because every once in a while you hear somebody say something really stupid. But there's so, you know, there's so much layering going on there. It does sound like a mob. It sounds pretty sinister at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is a little bit of the witch hunt, but it's not actually
the witch hunt. The whole song is kind of dark.
It's dark, foreboding, moody,
brooding.
Yeah.
It's
creepy intro.
Yep.
It really sets the mood.
Totally. Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
It's probably my least favorite on the album, actually. It's...
The lyrics kind of set the scene. I mean, the lyrics really match the music or vice versa, whatever the two. I mean, they really do go hand in hand on this song.
Yeah. Another one, right?
Yeah.
They do a good job of that.
Right.
I mean, it's a very dramatic song.
Yep. Yep. I'm probably with Lance. The Camera Eye might be my least favorite, but Witch Hunt.
Yeah.
Apparently, yeah. Yeah, this side. Yeah, I mean, this side is probably,
I don't dislike it.
Right.
But it's just so starkly different.
Yeah.
Than side A mm-hmm. or side one, whatever
Agreed.
You want to call it. It doesn't, like I said on Camera, it doesn't get up and go. It's
not catchy. You're not going to be singing it as you're walking along on a nice sunny day.
Yeah. But, you know, we're talking about Rush here.
You know what song is just stuck in my head?
What?
Witch Hunt.
Yeah. I can't get that out of my head either.
You're not going to hear that.
Na, 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 na. You mean Witch Doctor.
Yes. Yes.
They got me Witch Doctor. I told me what to do.
Didn't we talk about that in a previous episode? Callback.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think we might have.
I remember listening to that on the Looney Tunes KTEL collection. Witch Doctor.
Did we do a soundtrack?
Not yet.
No.
I can't remember when it was.
Spoiler alert.
Still drinking, aren't you, Lance?
Yeah. All right, let's move on. Last song on the album, Vital Signs.
We're all surprised that this was a single.
Yeah, the second single. You know what? They said they wrote this in the studio in like 5 minutes.
Yeah?
Well, okay. I would say this was a nod to what the future of Rush was going to be. It feels like something that could have been on Vital Signs. Vital Signs. Yes. That's the name of the album after this, right?
No. Signals.
Signals.
But it is a signal. It is a vital sign.
Yes. Yeah. This sounds it's something that could have been on Signals because it has this kind of catchy little, I don't want to say reggae-influenced guitar riff, but kind of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's catchy and different than... A lot of stuff that I'd heard previously, but not unlike stuff on Signals. So, yeah, maybe it was a hint at where they were going.
Mm-hmm.
Bands do that from time to time.
They do.
How many times have we come across, by the way, this is the last song they wrote for the album, and it's in the last position.
Mm.
I don't know how often we've come across that in any other album reviews. And then it was this, you know, we talk about where they kind of pick singles.
Yeah.
I don't know that I would put this at the end if it's going to be your number two single.
Right.
You know, we need to verify that whole thing. Maybe Wikipedia was messing with us because I, you know, honestly, I never heard this song on the radio.
No.
It's really strange. Maybe they wanted you to listen in reverse order.
Reverse polarity.
Oh, I like that.
Like, how do you get that into a song?
I don't know.
And then... Here, Getty, sing about reverse polarity.
We got a reverse polarity.
And not only that, but everybody needs it. I mean, do you need it? Do I need it? Do we all need it?
Apparently. Wow. Getty is telling us we need it.
Yeah.
I don't have much to say about it other than, it's fine.
The pulsing synth throughout the whole song, and then it's kind of a little slower and moody and... but that pulse keeps the same, but the music slows down and picks up. So mm-hmm. I thought that was kind of interesting.
Another kind of unique.
It did, yeah, I noticed that too. About halfway through, it kind of picked up too and moved.
Yeah.
Unlike the previous two on mm-hmm. this side.
Anything more on vital signs before we wrap this up?
Checking mine.
I'm doing a little research here. But
checking your keep signs. You're still alive.
Lance just fell over. His crown is on the ground.
Oh, whoa.
Uh-oh. Hey, pick it up.
Got
Get
it.
Back in your seat.
Got
man.
It.
Yeah.
Can't leave here without it.
No.
I think maybe I did see somewhere that vital signs was a single in the UK.
Yep, I'm looking at it right now, Brian. It was released as a single in the UK, peaking at number 41.
Oh, okay. Well, that would explain a lot.
So that's why we never heard it on the radio.
Yeah.
So
they only released two singles in the US.
Did you know that classic rock readers voted Vital Signs the 37th best Rush song?
Wow.
Out of how many songs are there?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, if there's only, you know,
a lot of their albums only have like five or six. Exactly. So,
yep.
Listen at five.
Although they have released quite a few albums. I mean, if this is their eighth album, I mean, really, it took them eight albums to really hit it big, hit the big time. That's.
Yeah. At 2112, they were worried they're going to be dropped by the label.
Yeah.
But there was such a groundswell support for that album amongst their diehard fans that they were able to keep going a little bit longer. But yeah, they were in danger of being dropped at one point.
Which could be a lot of the reasoning why they made this first side sound the way it did.
For sure. Yep.
Ready to wrap up?
Wrap it up.
All right. From a January 1981 interview when Music Express, which is Canada's entertainment tabloid, Geddy Lee had this to say about their songwriting. I assume that most of our audience is intelligent. I have to assume that. There are two ways you can write songs. Either you approach the lowest common denominator, or you assume everyone out there is the ideal listener. We prefer the latter approach. We try to appeal to their intelligence. I'd say that's pretty darn mm-hmm. accurate.
Yeah.
All right. Any final thoughts before we give a rating here?
I just have one more thing I remember reading where Geddy said that Neil, as they went further along in their career, he tended to want to do less than he was typically known for. So his drumming, you know, he was toning it down, I guess you could say. And so they really had to encourage him to keep doing what you're doing.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
He wanted to just not do as many like crazy, super fast fills and stuff.
Yeah.
I believe he actually studied under, I can't remember which famous drummer, and he changed his style too.
Mm.
After this?
It was after this. Okay. Yeah. And it probably has a lot to do with, you know, his does want to do the same thing over and over again. I want to grow as an artist.
Maybe a less is more. I don't know.
Yeah, that could be too.
But so anyway, they were encouraging him to keep doing it. And he did.
Plus
he did keep doing it. But
a lot of hard work to replicate what he had been doing in concert.
Wow. Well, isn't that one of the reasons he stopped touring for a while too? It's just, I mean, so much wear on your body.
Exhausting.
Mm-hmm. Ligaments and all that stuff. I mean, you're getting older and
you
just wear and tear. I mean, out of all the musicians, you know, that one's just moving so many body parts so much compared to a guitarist or a lyricist or a keyboard player.
It was funny seeing him at this time period, you know, he just looked like this small, skinny guy on the drum kit. It's just like, wow, this is a powerful kid.
Was he he was the youngest of the three too?
That correct? I don't know.
Okay. But maybe I was just assuming that from the way he looked, because he looked so much younger and lanky.
Yep.
All right, guys, it's time to give our personal rating this album from 0 to 10. Where do you guys stand on this one? I honestly hadn't thought about it until just now.
Okay. Well, what'd you think of then?
I didn't use
the Lance rating system.
No,
I didn't
for this one. I, for some reason, completely skipped that in my process. So I'll just have to make up something on the spot after you guys both give your rating. I'm stalling for you both now.
Yeah, well, I used my rating system, and tell you what, I'm at a 9. I know I've been high on the last couple, but, you know, the first side, every song to me is a 10.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't dislike the second side, but when I start adding the numbers, it's like, well, there you go. There's only three songs in the second side, so I came up with like a 94% or 0.94. So I'm going to stick with the 9. It didn't go above 9.5, but it's a great album. You know, is it their best? I don't know. They have a lot of great stuff, but certainly the most approachable for, and as we said, most radio friendly. And I'm not ashamed to give it a 9.
And you shouldn't be.
No. Why would you be?
Yeah.
How about you, Brian?
I'm giving it an 8. Solid. I like it. Side one, obviously the stronger the side. I feel the same way.
Probably the best side one of any album.
I don't know about that, but it's really it's for me. Good. It doesn't drop off. And I thought too, what is YYZ? Is that like the second or third song? Third song. Instrumental. I mean,
yeah.
How many bands do that?
Yeah.
And to make it a memorable song. That's pretty impressive. So I'm going with an 8.
I am smack dab in the middle of both of you. 8.5. I, you know, having this album, listening to it so much, I think talking through it and analyzing it, I realize, you know, maybe I don't like all the songs on the second side as much as the first side, especially. Like you said, I mean, that's a banger of a first side. But I still have a kind of that nostalgic feel.
Yeah.
So you got to rank them probably a little higher than I would normally on a cold listen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But 8.5 for me.
Yeah.
It's time for Remember When. This is a segment where I ask Brian and Lance their thoughts about something we grew up with but may no longer be around today. And as they're getting comfortable, today's item, which I believe is almost entirely extinct. Maybe you can guess.
Dodo birds.
The dodo birds.
Yes. It's the dodo bird. Yes. It's so related to rock and roll and 70s and 80s culture. I thought we'd just revisit the dodo bird. Oh my gosh.
We like dodo birds.
We do. I miss them.
Well,
why
unfortunately,
all those people of California have to kill the dodo birds.
Okay, if it's not that, it's got to be the passenger pigeon.
it's the passenger. Oh, man.
Dave, you got to come up with something more original. Come on.
I'm putting those both down as future items. Passenger pigeon. No. This item that's almost entirely extinct, video rental stores.
Oh.
Yeah?
Did you have a membership and how many different stores?
Oh, man.
Oh boy, I can think of 3 for sure.
Yeah, at least.
Right here in town.
Yeah.
Three of them that exist. Oh, that did exist.
That did exist. Mm-hmm. Everyone had Blockbuster. Remember,
eventually. I didn't have that one for the longest time.
They didn't come to Mankato for a while.
Yeah.
Lewis Rents. Lewis Drugs.
Yeah.
We had a Lewis Rents.
That was probably the first one I had here.
Yeah.
That's okay. I'm up to 4.
Family video.
Family video, yep. Yep.
Video update. They were in the mall by the Happy Dan's.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, right on the corner. It's a big store.
Okay.
Video USA?
Yes.
Video USA, yep.
Yeah.
There was a little one in Belmar Mall, Video.
Yep. Went Belmar Video.
So there were a few around.
There was a few around. Mm-hmm. Hy-Vee.
Hy-Vee, yeah, we were rented from Hy-Vee downtown. Yeah.
The grocery store.
They were cheap, too. I think they were like 99 cents all the time.
I remember...
Everybody trying to get on the action.
Lewis Drug, I remember having you could buy a card or something that was like a punch card.
Yes.
Really cheap. And then when the store closed, we had like X amount still left on it, and we were able to like send it in, and they like paid us back. For what we didn't use.
Really?
Wow.
I'm thinking, this is crazy.
Yeah.
Not sure why I would do that.
I know.
But they did. Wow.
They did.
Bonus money to go buy other stuff at Lewis Drug.
Yeah.
Man.
Video stores were so fun.
Oh, it was awesome.
Fridays, Saturdays, you know, hard to find what you want.
Yeah.
And you're elbow to elbow with people and you're,
You know how you're on Netflix now or you know, Paramount Plus and you can't pick anything out. It was the same thing in the video store. You'd spend an hour in there.
It was, yeah. Really. Yeah. Because you'd go, oh, I could watch that, but I'll keep looking.
Yep.
Oh, I could watch that one. Okay, that's my number two. I got to remember where number one was.
Yep.
And then keep looking. Especially when you didn't have like a new release that wasn't in or mm-hmm. you couldn't find or...
Yeah, wasn't it always such a thrill when, you know, there's this jackpot of the
new release?
10 copies of the new release, and I got one.
Oh, yeah. I think at one of the places local, they'd have a whole, like, two sections of walls. So it was like 100 copies or 50 copies or whatever it was.
That was probably Blockbuster.
Yeah, probably. So I had my brother Wayne and my friend Channing, who you both know, actually. They both worked at a Family Video. I think it was called Family Video. Mm-hmm. Kind of a ubiquitous name for video store, right? So I get to watch a lot of movies for free. They just bring home. Sometimes they'd get the manager would get like a preview copy with like a timestamp on it before, so he could watch it to see how many he wanted to order or whatever it was. So we'd watch them before they were at the video store.
Wow.
So that was kind of cool. But I do remember having a lot of video stores around, just the experience of going in. So I said almost extinct because isn't the one Blockbuster still around?
Yeah. I saw that on the internet recently. Where is it? Like in
Bend, Oregon.
Oregon.
Yeah. I drove past it a few months ago, back in the spring of this year.
Which is just crazy. I'm sure it's just a nostalgic
trip. Yeah. I was driving. I'm looking out the window. I'm like, what? Blockbuster? That's the one. I mean, they've got a documentary on that store and everything.
That's a cool documentary, too. If you haven't seen it, you should go watch it.
And you wonder how in the world it could still be there. I don't even get it.
I think it's just a lot of people who want to just like, what? We could still go into a video store and just go rent something and
I don't know.
Just for the experience, even if they just do it once.
Yeah.
They don't even have a DVD player, but they'll go in.
I do remember having to like rent a VCR at times. It's like, oh, we're going over to a friend's house and they don't have a VCR. I guess we'll have to rent the VCR too.
Oh, now that you're saying that, the first experience I had with a home rental was over at some friends of ours, some family friends, and they wanted to rent Coal Miner's Daughter.
Mm.
And I think at the time, you know, there wasn't a really good system in place, so they had brought home like the package for it, and it was just an unmarked case. And maybe it actually probably had just it written on the top. It wasn't the actual like... Will you buy, you know, today's versions or yesterday's versions with like the pictures on it and stuff. Anyway, but we get it there and open it up and it's not Coal Miner's Daughter. It's Flash Gordon.
Oh,
so we watched that.
Yeah.
Which was a pretty cool movie. Flash Gordon. And then took it back.
So, and said, oh, hey, gave us the wrong one.
And then
one.
They gave us Coal Miner's Daughter. So we watched that one too. And that was something like the adults wanted to watch. So they all watched that one.
Soundtrack and Flash Gordon by Queen.
It's a really fun movie.
Yeah.
Flash.
He saved every one of us. It's an awesome movie. Awesome soundtrack.
You also had that time where we got to get home and watch this before we have to return it.
Yeah. Otherwise, what about late fees? Extra. You ever guys? Pay some late fees ever? Yeah.
Not rewinding.
Did you get like multiple movies too? Like the 3-day checkout? We're like, well, we better get two or three because it's only an extra $2 if you get this extra one.
Yeah.
And then you're like, well, I know what we're doing for the next two evenings.
Yep.
Right. And sometimes a double feature just to get it in under the time frame.
Yeah. It was a commitment, wasn't it?
It was.
Yeah.
That's kind of
everything
cool.
was a commitment. Well, back
it
then.
Was it was intentional, and now it's just like kind of flippant.
Yeah,
you know,
it was an activity. I mean, it was,
and the family gathered around, right?
Yep,
for sure.
Good times.
Good times. That will do it for today. In our next episode, we're getting into the Christmas spirit and going through each of our top five Christmas songs. So looking forward to that episode. If you missed our previous episode, we talked about the album Synchronicity from The Police. Interesting album with varied styles. Great conversation about it. So if you haven't listened to it yet, be sure to go back and check it out.
Folks, if you are still enjoying these podcasts, I think they're getting better.
The episodes are getting better.
I think we're getting smarter.
Oh, smarter. Really?
Wow. Well, says the king.
Maybe.
One of us is reigning supreme.
Whatever the case, do us a favor and click share or whatever on whatever platform you're listening to this on and send the episode link to a friend and help spread the word about When Records Ruled. And also, let us know if there's an album or topic from the 70s, 80s you'd like to hear about. And maybe, we still haven't done this yet, maybe we'll talk about it in a future episode.
Well, we need some feedback.
Yeah, give us some feedback.
Honestly, just send us a message over Facebook or a comment on a post that I throw out there.
Yep.
Do it.
Give us some feedback. We'd appreciate it.
Yep.
I was just going to say, yeah, leave us a review while you're doing that, too. Yeah. Click the 5 stars, and we'd appreciate that. What else is there to say?
Go back. Know, and
you can also check us out.
You're just trying to wing this, aren't you?
I lost my place. Anyway, check us out on...
Do it a couple times.
Check us out
on... 10 stars.
Check us out on... Check us out on... Check us out on Facebook. Check us out on Instagram.
You're like scratching that.
Check it out.
Check it out.
At whenrecordsruled.com. No, .com.
We don't have a .com.
Okay, when records ruled on Facebook or Instagram. And you can also follow us on those and leave us comments and check out Dave's cool photos and things that he throws up there.
Dave's been making an effort to make our photos even more interesting. So
yeah,
take a look.
Share those.
Be more interesting than the podcast itself.
Yeah, maybe.
There's also a Spotify playlist out there that you can check out the songs of any of the previous episodes that we've discussed.
Look in the description and the podcast episodes.
And remember, despite what Lance kind of alluded to earlier, we are not professional music critics.
No. We're getting close.
We're really just 3 guys who like talking music.
And that's all. Thanks for listening, everyone. We'll see you next time.
See ya.
Later.